Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come here tonight knowing that we are sinful men and women, the way all men and women have been as seen in the Bible throughout the history that we read there. And we read in the Bible that you have been pursuing us, speaking to Moses from the mountain, then finally moving down among the camp in Israel to live in the tabernacle and traveling with them to Jerusalem, where you caused your presence to dwell in the temple, and then finally becoming flesh and tabernacling among us in Jesus Christ. And ultimately now, Lord, the Bible teaches us that you live in us, that the Holy Spirit lives in us. All this time you've been coming closer and closer to us despite our faithlessness and our sin. We thank you for this, Lord, and we ask you, please, to pursue us yet again tonight, to be here with us and among us and in us, causing us to see you and to hear you in your word in ways that are marvelous and that are pleasing to you and beneficial to us. We pray, Lord, that everything that happens here will be, like it says in the book of Leviticus, a pleasing aroma to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So 2 weeks ago, we began a new study of the Old Testament book of Leviticus. And the first week we did only general introductory material. Last week we also had some introductory material, but we started reading chapter 1 and we read to verse 9. We have not, it seems to me, quite finished discussing the first 9 verses of chapter 1, but tonight we will. And tonight we will also finish reading and discussing the rest of chapter 1. I wanted to say to you guys, don't worry, I'm not planning on spending 3 weeks in every chapter of Leviticus. I'm starting slow because the material is so unusual and unfamiliar to most people, including to me. And also I think from my reading and preparation that a proper study of Leviticus basically has to begin with a lot of introduction. If you think Leviticus is hard to understand and you struggle with it, what I can tell you from the hours that I've spent reading so far is the church has been struggling for 2,000 years to know how to read Leviticus the right way, and scholars and pastors struggle still today to understand the right way to read Leviticus. And I personally struggle a lot. I'm reading and thinking and praying a lot more than I normally do for other books of the Bible that we study, trying to do justice to this rather unusual and difficult book. And so I think I'm finding my footing and we'll speed up a bit, but we have taken a while to get through the end of the first chapter. And please do pray for me and for us that our experience Leviticus will be a pleasing aroma to God. Because there is so much general introductory stuff, and I'll try not to keep going back and reviewing the same things over and over again, I wanted to remind those of you who don't already know, the class has a website and various things are on there. The most important maybe is the YouTube videos of these classes. And if the Spirit moves you and you have time, I know it's not easy, I would encourage you to go back and look at some of those for background information on Leviticus. The videos are not professional and basically they're unedited, so that means there's some time that goes by that you may not want to watch all of. But they do seem to capture some things that are worth remembering. Even I, reviewing them myself, just to remind myself of things that I've thought and studied in the past. So it's www.bibletalk.jp, not .com. That's what the homepage looks like. And I think everybody here knows how to use the internet, and so you can find that if you haven't already found it. If you have trouble, please ask me. It seems to be working fine. All right, now tonight, I'm not just going to jump right in. I want to begin with a thought, with a reminder that in back of everything that we're studying now in this class sits the covenant between God and his people. And I have in mind here particularly the covenant which Moses confirmed between God and his people most recently in the book of Exodus. You remember, after being up on the mountain with God and receiving the Ten Commandments and other laws, Moses came down and he told the people all the words and all the words of the Lord and all the rules. So God was speaking to Moses. Moses conveyed that to the people. And then the people answered with one voice, united voice, saying, "All the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do." This is a covenant, a promise, an agreement, a pact between God and his people. Basically, God promised to be their God. He promised to sustain them, to protect them, to deliver them to the land of promise, to make them a blessing to all the nations. And what they promised from their side is to obey all of the things that God told them to do. Okay, there is this covenant behind our present study that we shouldn't forget. And it's worth remembering while we're here that the covenant that I'm talking about now with Israel in the time of Moses was just a reaffirmation and continuation of a covenant that God had with the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And God's covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was a reaffirmation and continuation of a covenant that God had with Noah. I'll talk more about what they call the Noachian covenant, you know, tonight. But basically, God looked at the world and saw everything was evil, but there was Noah. So he told Noah to build the ark, and you know the story. And when the flood subsided, Noah built an altar and burned an offering to the Lord, and it was a pleasing aroma to the Lord. It says even that far back in the Bible. And God made a covenant. He decided not to destroy the world. And he put the rainbow in the sky. And he promised Noah that he would never, you know, erase humanity, erase the world, and start over again. All right? And in some sense, I think, you know, God's covenant with Noah is just a promise that God's going to save the world some other way. Okay. So the covenant begins near the beginning of the Bible, and it gets renewed with successive people, including Moses and the nation of Israel in the time that we're studying. But if you look forward in history, that same covenant gets renewed and reestablished with other people who come later, notably King David and his son Solomon. God promised David that somebody from his line would sit on the throne forever. All right? And finally, as Christians we understand, but of course the Jews in the day of Moses couldn't have understood, we understand that when Jesus came, he was the fulfillment of all of the promises that God had made to all of those people previously. The Bible says he's the yea and amen to all the promises of God. Everything is fulfilled in Jesus, right? So the Bible honestly reports that all human beings from Adam all the way forward to me and you and the people who will come in the future until Christ comes again and rebuilds the world perfectly, all of us are continually evil all the time. I don't think we're any better or worse than the people in Moses' time. Nevertheless, God, throughout the whole Bible story, is chasing us. God is calling people. He's making promises to people. He's keeping his promises to people. His people are promising things to him. Yes, God, I will obey you, and breaking his promise. Right? This is the sort of overarching narrative of the Bible. And the covenant at Sinai, where our current study begins, is just one chapter in a long history of God pursuing sinful people and trying to save them. All right? It's one story with many chapters, and every chapter resembles the others in this respect. There's a covenant behind it. And what men always do is break covenants. We transgress the rules that God has given us. In the story that close to the book of Leviticus, immediately after Moses, you know, came down from the mountain with God, he found out that the people in Israel had done exactly the opposite of what God commanded. Right? They'd melted gold jewelry, they'd made themselves an idol, a golden calf, and they were worshiping God using this golden calf. And this is one of the supreme examples in the Bible, one of the supreme examples of all time, of how stupid and how wicked and how faithless people can be. It was just amazingly bad what they did. God had just told them, don't do things like that. And that's what they did. And yet, if you and I had been there, probably all or most of us would have done exactly the same thing. We would have been melting our jewelry and helping them to build the golden calf because they had persuaded themselves that that was somehow the right thing to do, and they were wrong about that. So the whole history of humanity is so tragic that to me that it's almost funny, because wherever you look, people will be doing, you know, the most awful things. And this is particularly grotesque within the covenant community. I mean, the reason why the golden calf was so awful was because it was done by God's chosen people who had promised to do everything, you know, that God would say. The reason why the crucifixion of Christ was so awful, it was done within the covenant community of Israel. The reason why evil, unspeakable things that Christian nations have done in later history are so awful, for example, Nazi Germany was a Christian country, it was because they're done in the midst of covenant people. You know, there's no end to it. The evil is everywhere. Okay. So the nature of things then is that God calls people and to himself. God makes promises to them. We make promises to God. We break our promises. And nevertheless, God pursues us. Ever since he told Noah, I'm not going to wipe out the world, God had something else in his mind. We know as Christians, ultimately what God had in mind was to send his son Jesus to save the world. But in the history between then and then, which is most of the Bible story that we read, people had to do something else to atone for their sin. All right, and so there was this episode with the golden calf, but because Moses interceded and God is gracious, the covenant was renewed. The tail end of Exodus has to do with God giving additional instructions about how to worship him properly and how to complete the temple. And then when Leviticus begins, we see something amazing happen. Despite this unspeakable perversity of mankind and the chosen people of Israel, God decides he's going to dwell among them. God's going to move in with Israel. And that's why the tabernacle is created. More often in the translations we read, it's called the tent of meeting. The tent of meeting and the tabernacle are the same thing, just two different names for the same thing. And it's just another effort by God to redeem stubborn people. He promises Moses that despite everything they have done and have just done, he's actually going to accompany them on the way to the promised land. He's going to go with them. And so Leviticus' opening scene is like what I was thinking. It's like the grand opening, you know, the grand opening of a supermarket or the grand opening of some, you know, department store. This is the grand opening of the tabernacle is what we have at the beginning of Leviticus. And the tent of meeting, the grand opening of which we're witnessing, is two things, or it has two purposes or aspects. It is a tent of meeting. If you read your Old Testament, it's the place where God would call his people and meet with them and talk to them, especially Moses. All right, this is the place where they would meet. And it was also a dwelling place, which is, I think, where you get the word tabernacle. That is to say, a place where God would cause his presence to be. Of course, God is everywhere, but for Israel, he would cause his presence to be in this place for them so that they would know where they were supposed to go to offer sacrifices to atone for their sin properly. All right. So this is an astonishing example of God's grace, one of many throughout the history that we read in the Bible. God's effort to make himself more available, more present to the people in Israel. And it's worth noticing before I turn the page that this tabernacle in some sense is like Jesus. The tabernacle is a place among people where God would cause his spirit to dwell among them. In the first chapter of John, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and several chapters later it says, the world became flesh, and most translations say lived, but I think you could also translate tabernacled among them, all right? When Jesus came, God was moving even closer. Okay. But this is a step in that direction in God's marvelous plan. And it's actually instructive. I read this in a commentary, and I thought it was interesting enough to share it with you guys. It's instructive to compare Exodus 19:3 with the first verse of Leviticus, okay? Because in Hebrew and also in English, there are substantial and interesting similarities, all right? So back in Exodus, when God and Moses were going to speak, Moses had to go up, had to climb up the mountain to go talk to God. And then when he climbed up there, often it's at a high mountain, you get the feeling he was like way up there. He'd climb up to the high mountain, then he'd get there and he'd wait, and then God would speak to him from out of the mountain. Sometimes there'd be clouds. But anyway, that was the way that God spoke to Moses. And here it says when he was up there, when God spoke to Moses from out of the mountain, what God would say is the things that Moses should say to the people of Israel. Right? God would tell Moses, go tell them this stuff. Okay. In the passage I'm citing here, just after this is when the Ten Commandments are given and all the other laws are given. And as I just related, after he comes down and the incident with the golden calf and Moses intercedes and the covenant's repaired, then they proceed to build the tabernacle. So from Israel's perspective, God had moved. From their perspective, since leaving, you know, Egypt, God was always up on the mountain. That's where God came when he was going to talk to Moses, when he was going to talk to Israel. But now God is moving. That's the sense of my slide. God is moving someplace else, all right? So God moved to the tabernacle. That's where they would find God after that. So in Leviticus 1:1, if you look there, Moses doesn't have to climb mountains anymore. God's not up on the mountain for them. God's down in the tabernacle. And God doesn't speak to them from out of a mountain anymore. God speaks to them from out of the tent of meeting, which is right there in their camp, right? They live around God. God is there in the center of them. God is the center of them. And that's where he speaks to them from, speaks to Moses from. And what does God do, though, is almost the same. Whether he's on the mountain or whether he's in the tabernacle, is what God does is he says to Moses, tell the people these things. Okay. And please notice that whether it's on the mountain or whether it's in the tabernacle, wherever God is when he's speaking, there's no mention made of Moses being told to write any of these things down. And I don't know how you should think about that, because what it raises the question, are the words that follow, the things that Moses communicates from God, are those words supposed to be like verbatim, detailed description of what God said, which seems unlikely a little bit, or is Moses just explaining sort of the things God wants people to understand using the words that he picks and they get recorded in the Bible, which would mean you could be reading this sort of like you read the Ten Commandments, words that will never change forever, right? That's how the Ten Commandments are. Or it could be like a letter that Paul wrote to one of the churches in the early Christian, you know, in the early Christian era, telling them you should do church this way, right? Somewhere in between there, I guess, is how you'd understand the words that God speaks to Moses and Moses speaks to the people, because he's addressing a lot of very practical issues about worship here, in what follows. So I don't know the answer to that question, but I think it's an interesting question. Right. So now we're talking about the period in history where God is in the tabernacle. He's speaking to Moses. And what the first thing God wants to communicate to Moses after moving into the tabernacle, okay, is to communicate to everyone in Israel information about how they should offer sacrifices to the Lord now that the tent of meeting has been established and God has moved in. This is what's new. What's new is the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, and God's location from Israel's perspective. God's with them now. They wouldn't know how, and they probably would guess wrong about how they're supposed to approach God and offer him to do sacrifices. Their instincts aren't real good, as we've seen with the golden calf. And so here God wants to tell them, okay, when you give your offerings from now on, here's how you want to do it. And the word translated here in the introduction to chapter 1 is offering is a word that is generally understood in its use as an animal sacrifice or a whole burnt offering. A couple things I wanted to notice that I forgot to say last week, or I didn't know last week, is, first of all, when the grammar says, when any one of you makes an offering, the Hebrew very specifically means to include both men and women, which is interesting. There are animal sacrifices in the more detailed rules that follow where the woman is the one who's making the offering, or a man is the one who's making the offering. But basically, these offerings are gender neutral. This is a word that's going out to all human beings in Israel. Okay, and when it says in Israel, it could mean literally everyone who's genetically descended from Jacob. That's the tightest definition, but probably it's not that tight, because there are other people who can enter into the covenant of Jacob, the nation of Israel, by marriage or by other means. All right, and so really this word is going out to anybody who's part of the community of faith, part of the covenant community with God. Anyone who's going to try and want to be united with God in this kind of fellowship needs to listen to these sacrifices. And just a kind of a point that always pops into my mind. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 39, the Apostle Paul teaches that if we belong to Christ, then we are sons of Abraham and heirs according to the promise. Paul's view is we're Jewish too in every important theological respect. Christians and Jews are part of one church. It's the ecclesia. It's God's people called from out of the world to worship him. And so in Christ, Jews and Christians are one. We're united. And so these words that we hear spoken here are spoken to us too, although they're spoken to us at a much later time in history after Jesus has already come. And so we'll understand these words differently than they would have, because they didn't know about Jesus yet. Okay. The other thing I wanted you guys to notice, but I did mention this last week, is God is presuming that people will offer sacrifices. In chapter 1, he's not requiring that these sacrifices be made. He's saying, if you do, when you do, but he's not here requiring that they do. And if you think about it for a while, this makes really, really good sense, because animal sacrifice has been a common part of human life going back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, going back to Noah, going back to Cain and Abel. People offered animal sacrifices, right? And that was true not only in Israel, but throughout all the nations known to Israel. Human beings in those days would worship, and when they would worship, what they would do is they would offer animal sacrifices. So it may seem strange and barbaric to us now, you know, in the 21st century, particularly those of us who are animal lovers. But until the Christian era, really until 50 or 60 or 70 years into the new millennium, into the Christian era, animal sacrifice was the main and constant aspect of human worship directed towards God. It was how people atoned for sin. All right. So, finally, to be clear, all of chapter 1, which we started last week and we'll finish tonight, is speaking of individual people voluntarily making offerings on behalf of themselves, or perhaps their families. But, I mean, these are basically personal offerings of animals. Other kinds of offerings will be talked about later in Leviticus. But in chapter 1, all of these are if a person does it, when a person does it, then they should do it this way, right? And consequently, think about this, the sacrifices that are described here in chapter 1 will not be perceived as a burden to any godly person. They're voluntary. On the contrary, these sacrifices are God's grace. God is giving them away to be assured that they can keep their relationship with God intact. They know all of these rules in the Ten Commandments and all of that. They know they're going to break them often just like we do. They know if they want to remain in a relationship with God, something has to be done about their sin. And here's God showing up and saying, I got it covered. Here's how you're going to deal with your sin. When you offer sacrifices, you do it this way, and it may be acceptable to me, a pleasing aroma to me, and I may forgive you, right? So these people should be glad to have these instructions, because the most difficult thing about sacrifices is knowing whether or not they're acceptable to God. Right? So there's no guarantee that their offering will be accepted. But what's really sure is if they offer in some different place or to some different god or in some other way, their offering will not be accepted, but instead will be an abomination. Be an abomination to God. So the rest of chapter 1, which you know Steve read last week, is then giving instructions to the people, men and women in Israel, when you wish to offer an animal sacrifice to God, how should you do it, right? In order that it may, I should say, it may possibly be acceptable to God. This is not magic. There's no set of procedures you can check off and say, okay, God has to forgive me. God never operates that way, never. Not in the Old Testament, not in the New. But God is helping us understand how we can approach this thing. And all of these instructions, I think, are supposed to help people get their heart and soul in the right way so that God is going to be pleased with what they do. And as you may have noticed, the rest of chapter 1, verses 3 through 17, divided into three sections. Verses 3 through 9 have to do with cows. Verses 10 through 13 have to do with sheep and goats. Verses 14 through 17 have to do with doves and pigeons. And these are, at that time, anyway, the only animals that can be sacrificed to Yahweh in Israel. One of the things you'll notice if you read forward in your Bible is there are a lot of small adjustments that happen in the way that people in Israel make sacrifices and offer and do worship in the tabernacle and in the temple. You get the feeling that worship practices in the Old Testament, as in the New, have to be a little bit flexible and adjusted to varying circumstances that there will be in the world. But I don't think anybody missed the point from the beginning when God spoke until now that the most important thing here is not the mechanical details of this, but rather the spiritual point of it all, right? Which is you're supposed to be approaching Yahweh for an atonement for sin and be careful about how you do it. The first section then has to do with cows, and it's also the longest section, you'll notice. And maybe we won't reread it. You'll have your Bible open. We read it last week, but I'll assume that you've read it and you can follow along with me. So the first section, verse, you know, has to do with cows. And the reason why it's longer and more detailed than the other sections may be, first of all, because details provided in section number 1 were generally assumed by the rabbis to apply to subsequent sections that apply to other kinds of animals, right? So if an instruction was given once for cows, and it seems natural enough that the same thing would apply to other four-legged animals that would be sacrificed, goats and sheep, it wouldn't be necessary, even normal in Bible writing, to write it again here. So some of the times you'll read a condition for a cow, not for a sheep and a goat, but that doesn't mean it doesn't apply to the sheep and the goats, just that it wasn't repeated. The second reason why the first section may be longer is that some of the details provided in the first section would be necessary for the grand opening ceremony of the tabernacle, of the tent of meeting. Remember, it's just been created. God's presence has moved in there, but now it's going to have to be dedicated, and the priests are going to have to be anointed, and all of that. And building the fire, which is talked about in the first section for cows, is something you have to talk about once, because you can't make a burnt offering until you light a fire. But since the rule was that the fire would then never go out forever, there's no reason to talk about building the fire again. The fire gets built once and it stays lit from their perspective. And also the opening ceremony of the tabernacle, which I'm thinking sort of the ceremony later described where they anoint Aaron and his sons as priests, uses a cow. All right, and so the first big opening sacrifice and at other times big ceremonial sacrifices may use a cow. And that's given first for those reasons. But it doesn't mean that cows were the main thing that was sacrificed in Israel. In fact, they weren't. I also personally wonder, I never read this in a commentary, this is my own idea, whether there isn't some connection to the golden calf story, which is just a few chapters earlier. That was a fake cow. You know, they took their jewelry, made a fake cow, and they worshipped it, and they got into a lot of trouble. Now we have here a real cow, which is 1,000 times more marvelous because God made it than anything human beings can fashion. And yet they're not going to worship this cow like some Hindu sect, right? The cow, on the contrary, is going to be slaughtered and offered to God as a burnt offering. And I'm not so sure that we couldn't see some connection there. Things have changed now in Israel. God has moved in, and they're going to have to worship the way God wants to. He's watching. They're living before God. And it's going to be cows this way, not golden cows like they had before. So one really quick review then of the details about cows from last week. Verse 3a says the cow has to be a male without blemish. And I pointed out last week that for cows and other animals, both in Israel and in the nations round about, it was almost always said that an animal offering should be a male without blemish. Last week I said that this is because male cows were more valuable. Actually, I was wrong. I read, and somebody pointed out to me, and I should have known this growing up in cow country. It's the females that are more valuable for two reasons. One, females make other cows, and two, females make milk. Males are actually, there's always too many males in a herd. And so especially people like this who have to travel around a lot, you'd want to get rid of the males. The ratio of males to females that's optimal for modern cattle ranching is like 1 to 50 or something like that. And so it may be that there's some ceremonial significance to the cow being a male, but from an economic point of view, probably God's making a concession to Israel, letting them sacrifice something that's actually less important to their survival. Female cows are really important to survival if you had children who needed milk and stuff like that. Then verse 3b says that sacrifices of cows can only be accepted before the Lord if presented at the entrance to the tent of meeting. So no more of this golden cow stuff. No more of this out on the mountain. No more going to somebody else's country where they might be worshiping other gods too. The only place now that you can sacrifice a cow is within Israel, in front of the tent of meeting where the presence of God resides. God is watching. That's where you bring the cow. And not only that, verse 4 says you have to bring it yourself. You have to bring your own sacrificial animal. You can't send your servant, even if you're a rich guy. The priests aren't going to come get it from you and do it for you. Because when you get there with your prize bull, the first thing that you have to do in order that this sacrifice might be acceptable to God is that you have to lay your own hands on the head of the cow, signifying something, and people struggle to understand the full significance of it. But one of the things you're signifying is, this is my offering for my atonement. My sin is here. The death that this animal is about to undergo is my death. The blood that's about to pour out might just as well be my blood. There's an identification and with the cow. And spiritually or theologically, you could say nobody else can offer atonement for your sin. It's your sin. You got to go to God straight and ask God to forgive you for your sin and do whatever you think you need to do in order for God to forgive you, right? And this doesn't mean God necessarily will forgive you in and of itself. It's impossible to imagine people that run to God in such a way that God would never forgive them, right? Because their heart isn't right. But one thing's for sure, if you want to be forgiven for your sin, you're going to have to go to God. There's no cult. Nothing you can pay, nothing you can ask somebody else to do. It's you and God from this very early time in among God's people. And I'm thinking to myself, this is just like Christian confession for sin, prayers offered in the name of Jesus. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. In Jesus' name, amen. If we want forgiveness just like them, we got to go to God by ourselves. And I think that this could be offered in argument against Roman Catholics and others who have various systems whereby priests or saints or the Virgin Mary or other kinds of intercessors are involved in approaching God. The Bible doesn't really seem to be lined up that way in the Old Testament and in the New. It's the one with the sin who has to go to God for forgiveness straight. When they went to God to ask for forgiveness, they brought cows and sheep and goats. When Christians go to God to ask for forgiveness, what offering do we bring? when people in the time of Moses went to God to ask for forgiveness for their sin, they brought animals. When modern Christians go to God to ask for forgiveness for sin, what offering do we bring?
Ourselves.
In a sense,
here I am. Forgive me of my sins.
But that would be true in both the Old Testament and the New. Right. So both guys are saying, and it's an important point, you always got to go and offer sincerely yourself, Lord, here I am.
Repentant heart.
That's true in the Old Testament and the New also. So you got to go yourself. You've got to offer yourself. You've got to be sincere. You need a repentant heart. They had to bring an animal. God said so. What do we bring? It's a really important question. What do we bring?
Jesus
Christ.
Yes,
Christ. That's exactly right. Jesus is our sacrifice. It's because of His sacrifice that we have hope that God will forgive our sins.
And in a larger theological context, the same was true for the people in Moses' time, but they didn't know it yet. They were offering animals as a sacrifice for atonement, for the forgiveness of their sin, but in the larger scheme of things, when they get to heaven, they're going to realize it was Jesus who interceded. The animal was just a symbol representing Christ on their behalf. Not everybody before Jesus was born went to hell. You know, they God provided different ways for them to atone for sin, but it's always Jesus' sacrifice that's finally effective in saving them from death and hell. All right. And so then in verses 5 and 6, the sincerity, as you guys say, we have to be sincere. The sincerity of the one confessing in the Old Covenant is probably helped by the hands-onness of the animal sacrifice. I mean, the one bringing the offering not only had to carry his prize cow, put his hands on it, but then he had to take a knife and butcher it himself and then cut it to pieces himself. In those early times, in the early days of Israel, no priest helped you with that. You did that yourself, whether you're a man or a woman, whoever you were. If you were offering the sacrifice, you were going to kill the cow and you were going to cut it up. And then the priest would come over and help you by collecting the blood that poured out of the cow that you've just killed. And he'd take that blood and splash it on the altar. And that was just reminding you and everybody that the life of the cow, which is in the blood, the Bible says, and was poured out, is being offered to God instead of your life. Because the wages of sin is death. The penalty for sin is death. The death that's being offered in substitution is the death of the cow. Maybe God will accept that. And if he does, you'll be reconciled with God, because otherwise God's holding out for your death, for your sins. And then the priest, in 7, 8, and 9, the priest butchers, puts the cut up meat, which the guy gives him, and puts it onto the fire. And before they burn the insides and the back legs, it's washed carefully, because the whole idea is to put the whole cow in offering to God, and it's supposed to be just meat, just like human beings would eat. No dirty stuff should be in there, from the intestines or whatever. Because I hate to say just symbolically, but what happens always with this and cows and I mean goats and sheep also is smoke goes up from the fire, and it's almost a ritual phrase, and it's a pleasing aroma to God. Right? And notice that again, the offering is made by the person who's trying to atone for their sin. The priests are only helping. Nothing's offered to the priests. And the priests are only helping because that's the job God assigned to them in Israel. They were born into Aaron's family. They had no choice. They had to go into the priest business. It's their job. All right. There's no shamanism. There's no magic. They just are helping people offer things properly to the Lord. And the whole thing is called here a food offering with pleasing aroma to the Lord. And people talk about what does food offering mean, and it seems to me there's two possibilities. In one sense, you could say, well, everything that's offered could be food for people. When I smell that aroma going up, that could have been my dinner. That was my cow or my pig or my goat or my birds. And the smell that goes up is the same smell that goes up when I cook it for my own family to eat. And in a nation of people who aren't overly wealthy and who don't have animals to spare, a food offering is actually offering food off my table. Or as Ricky said last week, that was kind of their money. It hurts. It's valuable. It's a real economic sacrifice. But the other way to understand it would be that a food offering is an offering of food for consumption by God. And if that's what it means, and that was a common way of thinking in the nations around Israel, that God somehow actually needed or wanted food, you know, that you were serving God by giving him food to eat. In Israel, nobody ever made that mistake. They would have always understood a meal for the Lord as a figure of speech, an extreme anthropomorphism that come to us. I mean, it's you're pretending that God is a man in a way that's ridiculous, right? We know that God doesn't eat. God doesn't need to eat. And yet, in a metaphorical sense, in a figurative sense, it's okay to talk about giving this as food to God, or giving God a pleasing aroma that he can smell. And God himself in his prophets uses that same metaphor upside down to describe his dissatisfaction with people. Remember the minor prophets? God would say, the smell of your burnt offerings makes me sick. You know, it turns my stomach, you know, God is saying. And the point is not that God eats or that God needs to smell burning meat. The point is that the pleasing to God, you know, a smoke going up from an offering is as pleasing to God as the soul of the person offering the offering is pleasing to God. That's why God smelled Noah's offering. It was a pleasing aroma to him, because Noah had obeyed God. Noah loved God. Noah wanted to be in fellowship with God. The same with Abraham. Right? And so I think you can have both senses of food offering. It is an offering of what would be food for people, and in a metaphorical sense, it's an offering of food to God. But what God really eats, what God really cares about, is the heart of the one giving the offering, as some of you had just said. Okay, that much we covered last week. Now tonight we get into the next section, and I want to keep moving so we're not still in chapter one. Next week. So, Steve, might I prevail upon you to read Leviticus just 1:10 at this
time. Okay. 1:10 reads, if his gift for a burnt offering is from the flock, from the sheep or goats, he shall bring a male without blemish.
Okay, so you can see here that even though bulls were mentioned first and spoken of at greatest length for reasons I've suggested, bulls are not by any means the only animals that you can sacrifice. You have to sacrifice an animal from the herd or from the flock. Herd means cows. We've talked about that. Flock means either sheep or goats. For the purpose of whole burnt offerings, which is what we're talking about in chapter 1, I read that it was sheep and not cows that were vastly the most frequent offering given in the Old Testament. So I guess if I read through my Old Testament or searched on my computer, I'd find out that when these kind of offerings were made, most often it would be sheep followed by cows. Goats are rarely mentioned as a sacrifice for whole burnt offerings, although Moses and God clearly allowed. Goats were usually only mentioned in purification ceremonies, which we'll be talking about in the future. But here I think one principle that you'll see, it's God's aim, and birds will prove it even more so, that everyone who wants to atone for sin is going to be able to do that, even if you can't afford a cow, even if you can't afford a sheep, even if you can't afford a goat, even if it's only some pigeon, you know. There's going to be a way for you to atone for your sin. Here with the sheep and the goats, again, the condition that the animal be male and without blemish is mentioned. I think for the same reasons we discussed. Here there is no mention of the laying on of hands as there was with the cows. And as I suggested earlier, I think they did lay hands on sheep and goats. They just didn't think it was necessary to write it again, since that principle had already been established with the cows. Now, could you read 11 through 13, Steve, please?
Okay.
Yes.
11 through 13 reads, And he shall kill it on the north side of the altar before the Lord. And Aaron's sons, the priests, shall throw its blood against the sides of the altar. And he shall cut it into pieces with its head and its fat. And the priests shall arrange them on the wood that is on the fire of the altar. But the entrails and the legs he shall wash with water, and the priest shall offer all of it and burn it on the altar. It is a burnt offering, a food offering, with a pleasing aroma to the Lord.
Okay, now here's one thing mentioned which is not mentioned in the case of the cows. And that is specifically where the one who's bringing the offering is going to butcher the animal. Here it says that the sheep or goats are going to be butchered on the north side of the altar. In a minute, I have a diagram for you. In a minute, we can look at. I found a good diagram, but for now, just assume he's standing on the north side of the altar. And probably people, most of the commentators think that bulls were also slaughtered on the north side of the altar, because if you look at all the other things going on in the courtyard, that's the most logical place to butcher anything. But we have to just assume that. It's actually not known inside the Bible for sure whether the bulls were also slaughtered there or somewhere else. Okay. But the rest of the steps that we just read for the sheep and the goats are the same as above for the cows. And you can compare. I pointed to the two differences. In the case of the sheep and the goats, they didn't specifically mention laying on of hands, but it's assumed. In the case of the sheep and the goats, they did mention specifically where to butcher the animals, unlike the cows, although in case of the cows, it's probably reasonable to assume they butchered the cows around that same area too. But otherwise, the two sets of instructions are the same. And the same result is in view. It's hoped that the blood that's shed and the life that's offered and the smoke that's wafting up to heaven are going to be accepted by God as an atonement for sin, are going to be perceived by God as a pleasing aroma, which to God means that the person is as God wishes for the person to be in his heart, in his soul. And that is, I started out tonight talking about covenant, but this is covenant renewal. We know the people are always breaking covenant with God, and by themselves it's hard to figure out how to fix that. God has provided the means for them to do that, and when they do this properly, and properly means not just mechanically but spiritually, when they do it properly, then God may accept that, and their relationship with God can be restored. God's chosen these people despite everything that they've done against him. He's chosen to cause his presence to dwell among these people. And because he knows that they're lost in sin and their hearts are constantly evil all the time, as he said in the time of Noah, God has provided this means for them to atone. Right? And we're reading about the process here that they had, the process of offering burnt sacrifices of animals. When this process is effective, God is pleased. I think that's the meaning of the pleasing aroma. And as I've already said, I think these Old Testament sacrifices are just sort of placeholders or foreshadowings of the true sacrifice which comes with Christ on the cross. And that's precisely what the author to the Hebrews is also saying much better than I have. Now, Noya, for you, I found a nice picture with copyright permission granted by Pastor Ralph F. Wilson. And so this is a simple diagram of the tent of the tent of meeting or tabernacle, as they call it. And the tent of meeting or tabernacle is actually how you refer to the inner structure, which contains the holy place and the holy of holies. The outer structure is the courtyard that surrounds the tent of meeting. So when God speaks from out of the tent, he's speaking from out of the small box, not the big one. As I mentioned last week, you see north, south, east, and west up there in the corner. This complex was always set up. It's mobile, so it has like tent poles, and you can pack it up and move it and then set it up again. Whenever they set it up with the entrance facing east. That's over here on the right. Right. The bronze altar just inside the entrance is where the animals are burned. We just read that the animals are butchered, at least the goat and the sheep, on the north side, which is on the right side of that altar. In the next story we read about the birds, we'll find out that part of the bird is thrown into the ash heap, and we're told there that it's on the east side of the altar, which makes sense that the ashes would be piled up between the altar and the door, because there are procedures for taking the ashes away from time to time. It'd be crazy to locate them any other place, since you have to take them out from time to time. The bronze laver is just a big thing full of water that they use for the washings that are required in the ceremonies that we read about. And then it's not in the Bible, but Jewish tradition states that there were like steps that you actually accessed the altar from the south. All right, so then that all makes sense. It's very much presented as a real place that was really open for business to do the things described here. There's some practical thought behind it, and I think Jewish people from the earliest times and still have an extreme fascination with this kind of descriptive information about the tabernacle and the temple, not just the structures, but also all of the procedures. But always, even the Jews, I think, understood and still understand that none of this is magic. There's nothing here that can be used by Israel or anyone to conjure God or to manipulate God or to trick or to force God into doing anything. It's quite the opposite. These people are absolutely lost and headed for destruction, and God has decided to come to them, to make his presence among them, to give them an opportunity to come to him and meet with him and approach him with confessions and atonements and offerings for sin. But if they're going to do it, they're going to do it in his place, with his items, his way. And the importance of the written rules is innovation is not encouraged when it comes to this kind of thing, because it quickly becomes magic or idolatry. It all has to be obedience to God, because that's the effective confession of sin, the effective atonement, is a heart that's approaching God in an obedient way, not in a sneaky way. Okay, I'll offer 20 bulls and blah, 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 and my sin will be taken away. The whole mood of the place, God is in control of this. God can forgive you because he's gracious, but there's nothing that will ever obligate God to forgive you, no matter what you do. So the rules that we're reading are helpful to the people who want to approach God. And then finally is the last few verses of Leviticus. Steve, could you read 14 through 17, please?
14 through 17 reads, "If his offering to the Lord is a burnt offering of birds, then he shall bring his offering of turtle doves or pigeons, and the priest shall bring it to the altar and wring off its head and burn it on the altar. Its blood shall be drained out of the side of the altar. He shall remove its crop with its contents and cast it beside the altar on the east side in the place for ashes. He shall tear it open by its wings, but shall not sever it completely. And the priest shall burn it on the altar, on the wood that is on the fire. It is a burnt offering, a food offering with a pleasing aroma to the Lord."
Isn't this a beautiful picture? I like this. I may put that on my wall. Anyway, So it's clear from the Old Testament and the New Testament, prophets and New Testament authors, and also from secular history outside the Bible, that there were often many poor people in Israel. And God always has a particular concern for the poor. You know, blessed are the poor. And I think it's for this reason, we read in verse 14, that provision is made to sacrifice not only animals, cows and goats and sheep, but also birds. As far as I know from my reading, turtle doves and pigeons were the only two birds which had been domesticated in Israel at that time. Remember, the general principle here is you cannot sacrifice a wild animal. It must be a domestic animal. If you let your mind dwell on it, you can see why it has to be that way. The wild animals belong to God. The domestic animals belong to you. The domestic animals are kept by you because you're planning to eat them or to trade them in barter. But when you give one to God, you're taking food off your table or money out of your pocket. You know, you can't just run out and grab a field mouse or some passing animal that you happen to be able to catch and go sacrifice it to God. It has to be a domestic animal. And in the category of birds, the people in those days raised and ate doves and pigeons. And I suppose that if you were a poor person and you could only afford to offer a pigeon or a dove in sacrifice, that might be your meat for the day or for the week. You know, and so it would be a real sacrifice, you know, to give that up. And the whole Bible knows, Jews and Christians have always known, that it's not, from God's side, it's not the wealth of the offering, but what it represents in terms of sacrifice and devotion from the side of the offerer. And so God doesn't want even poor people, men or women, to be excluded from this atonement that's being discussed here. Okay. Maybe it's because poor people are especially in view here that Moses and God do not repeat the principle that it has to be without blemish. It just can be any bird. It doesn't say it has to be a whole bird or a without blemish bird, a point that was mentioned twice before, but here it is not mentioned. Also not mentioned is a laying on of hands, because the verb that's translated laying on of hands is like a forceful pushing sort of activity, which only actually made sense linguistically with a large animal. And anyway, if you're going to offer a bird, I would argue, when you hand over the bird, the way that you hand over the bird amounts to laying on of hands anyway. You're going to have to hand it to the priest. And so in effect, the same principle, spiritual principle, is preserved. You're bringing your own animal, you're handing it over to God as an offering. Right. Still, I think, you know, the spiritual principle of offering the best that you can offer is still in play. So if you had several birds to choose from, you might be supposed to pick a nice one to give to God. Notice, though, that once you get there with your offering of a bird, the procedure, verse 15, is a little bit different than it is for the large animals. All right. I've already mentioned there's no laying on of hands. And here, unlike the other animals, the priest basically does all the work. Once you come with your bird and you give it to the priest, the rest of the activity is done by the priest. I understand this to be simply because birds are small. So if you think about how you handle animals, a cow will stand there, so will a sheep or a goat. A bird is a bird, and so you're going to take the bird and you're going to hand it over. And in order to sacrifice the bird in accordance with the same general principles that apply to the other animals, the way you're going to have to handle the bird is different, and I think that's exactly what's described here. Here it says, you take the bird in your hands, the priest now, you twist off its neck to kill it, you squeeze out a tiny little, not much blood will come from a bird. I used to go bird hunting when I was in high school, and I mean, you take the head off of a bird, you're not going to get much blood. A few drops maybe will come out. And so you're going to squeeze the blood out. You can't sprinkle it on the altar like with a large animal. There's not enough blood. So the priest is going to squeeze out the blood. Then he's going to pinch off the crop and its contents and toss it in the ashes on the east side of the altar. The crop is here. I have a picture if you want to see one. The crop is part of the digestive system of the bird. So the reason to do that is the same reason as washing the intestines of large animals, to just take the undigested food and stuff away. It may also be why the bird is broken, because to get to the crop in these birds, it might be hard to get to it unless, you know, say actually, after you twist off the head of the bird, open up the bird and take that part out. And then you're going to put the whole bird, including everything except the crop and its contents, onto the altar to make a pleasing aroma to the Lord. And I can't think actually of any other way that you could do it except to let the priest do that in one continuous process. It doesn't lend itself to draining blood and butchering and so forth and so on like is true with the larger animals. And so I think that the differences that you see with birds are practical differences. And if I'm right about that, there is a sort of theological point here to be drawn. This is not magic, you know. This is a process whereby people with contrite hearts can approach Yahweh and do something that may result in atonement for sin. And God's going to let it be expensive animals or cheap animals, and there's a way to sacrifice the animals you can sacrifice, so long as you take them from your barnyard or from your pigeon coop or some, you know, animal that you were going to eat anyway. That's the key point. And I don't think we need to be rabbis or great scholars to see the key points that are present here in this legislation, right? And what lies behind them. Does anybody need to see a picture of a crop? So this is the bird's head. And then the bird's throat, and when the bird eats stuff, the first place it goes is into the crop. There's some kind of pre-digestion that goes there. And then pre-digested food goes into the gland stomach and into the gizzard and then out. So when they twist the neck off to kill the bird and to get the blood out, they have to reach in and pull out their crop. And it may be, I didn't have time to research this carefully, but if you're going to break open the bird anyway, the way they say, by the wings, you just take that out and throw it into the ashes so that the bird is clean. You can understand the spiritual principle behind it, right? It has to be clean. It has to be like you would eat. It has to be the best thing that you have to eat, actually, in the category of animal given to God, so that the sacrifice will be pleasing. Where? Not because God needs to eat any of that stuff, but because it'll say something about your heart. Okay, let me conclude now. Give me 5 minutes. It's nine, but I had a few concluding reflections I wanted to share. So we've completed only the first chapter of Leviticus, and I had intended to cover more when I sat down to prepare for tonight, but I'm detained because I keep getting, you know, lost in my own reflections. Some I've shared tonight, and I want to conclude with some other things I want to share. Steve, could you turn back to Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 through 8, and read that.
Genesis 6, 5 through 8, okay. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord.
I'm sorry, did I lose you, Kazuko-san?
Did you find
Genesis 6, 5 through 8.
はい。じゃあ、ね、木に、毒素を残せつからどうの、こぐらのところです。主は人の悪が地にはびこり、すべてその心に思いはかることが、いつも悪いことばかりであるのを見られた。主は地の上に人を作ったことを悔いて心を痛め、私が想像した人を地の表から拭い去ろう。人も獣も春物も空の鳥までも、私はこれらを作ったことを悔い
So throughout human history, going at least back that far, man has been evil continually, to quote God. And God knows this, and the Bible is honest about this. That's maybe the most certain thing you can read in the Bible is the continual evil of mankind. One logical possibility, a logical possibility would be God would look at the earth the way it is, since he's a holy God, a perfect God, a good God, and say, such evil cannot be allowed to exist. I'm going to cancel it. I'm going to erase it, and I'm going to make something good. Right? And this logical possibility was contemplated by God in the Bible. We can see God have that thought, if I could say it this way, go through God's mind, and he's saying, I'm very disappointed with this, and I'd like to destroy it. But he noticed Noah. Okay. And so he turned aside from destroying the world, and he chose a person that he found to be holy, special, somehow pleasing to him. And Noah obeyed him and did what he said, and there's a whole story of Noah and the ark. God is saving humanity, evidently, because he has an idea to save it some other way. And when the floods subsided and Noah was back on dry land, which is a picture I have up here on the board, the first thing Noah did was to burn animals as a sacrifice to God. Steve, could you read Genesis 8, 20 through 22, please? 8, 20 through 22.
Genesis 8:20-22.
Wait a second until people catch it. Genesis 8, verses 20 through 22.
Okay. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I ever again strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease.
So this is the Noachian covenant. God put the rainbow in the sky as a symbol of his covenant that he would allow men to continue, despite the fact that God has said and told us that he sees that man is wicked, only wicked, all the time. And this is because God saw in Noah something pleasing. Noah sacrificed those animals and the smoke went up, and this is a metaphor. And God saw that picture, what that man was doing at that time in those circumstances, and he said, this is pleasing to me. I'm going to allow humanity to continue. And as I will keep saying, as Christians, we know God's end game. God was going to finally send his son Jesus. But the line between Noah and Jesus runs through Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, David, and other people who in some way, by God's grace, pleased God. God could find it in his heart to be pleased by some of these guys. And none of these guys were sinless. I mean, the Bible makes you see this, right? God called David a man after his own heart. David was an adulterer and a murderer. Jacob was a pretty rotten guy half the time. I mean, if you read the Old Testament, the Bible's not telling you to be like these people because they were sinless. But it may be telling us to be like these people because they were faithful, or because they longed after God, or because they wanted to reestablish a relationship with God, or somehow they were inclined to turn back in God's direction with a broken heart, with a contrite heart, and actually want to be reconciled with God. Those seem to be the people that God is pursuing. through all of his various ways, right, to looking for people that want to turn back and give them a way, okay, give them a way to turn back. Right now we're studying the people in Israel in the time of Moses. I think they're no more or less sinful than we are today. Right? A person needs to do something with their sin if they care about their relationship with God. I feel this every day, don't you? Other day I was walking out my door and I said, I wish they'd reestablish animal sacrifice, because I feel like going to sacrifice something, you know, because you think of a sin and you want to do something. And then you're reminded, like we said before, I don't need a sacrifice. Jesus was the one sacrifice for all sin, once and for all. But that same feeling that led people of old to want to go grab a cow and sacrifice it should grab us and lead us to confess our sins to Jesus and beg for forgiveness in his name, and to live the way he wants us to live, which is another kind of sacrifice, a sacrifice of praise or obedience. But the only atonement that there ever finally is the body and blood of Jesus Christ. That's the one that saves people so that they can turn back to God and mend their ways. Okay, so according to my reading, in the old days, people might have been able to once a year to offer an animal sacrifice, because it was a pretty expensive proposition for most people to sacrifice an animal. More godly people or more wealthy people among them might have sacrificed more frequently. I bet then as now, the people with the least sin sacrificed the most. And I find that with Christians, you know, people who I can't see anything that they do wrong always feel so sinful, and people who are very sinful sometimes don't feel so sinful. And you know, then as now, there would have been some people that are just hypocrites. They go sacrifice animals to make a show to their neighbors or whatever. But I want to conclude with this thought, and that is, the death of Christ on the cross can be compared, sort of carefully, and contrasted with whole burnt offerings in the Old Testament. The death of Christ on the cross can be compared carefully to the offering of burnt offerings in the Old Testament. What's exactly the same then and now and at all times and places, as I've been saying, is the sinfulness of man and man's need to deal somehow with sin if he wants to maintain a relationship with God. That's a constant of all time. Something also the same between then and now, I think, is covenant community. Israelites on the one hand, Christians on the other hand, both communities are people called from out of the world by God and are part of a covenant with God. In one way of thinking, John Calvin thought this way, it's all one community. The church, the ecclesia, to him was all of the people called out of the world, including the Jews in the Old Testament and Christians in the New. Anyway, God called a people unto himself. So for Israelites anyway, the way they had to atone for sin and to maintain fellowship with God and the covenant community was animal sacrifice. For Christians, what we have as our way to atone for sin and maintain fellowship with the covenant community is the sacrifice of Christ on the cross at Calvary. But what Christians have is so much better, and that's what the author of the letter to the Hebrews is saying. It's better in so many ways, which are detailed in Hebrews, but one of the ways is it's available to us at every moment. Christ's sacrifice was once and for all. It doesn't need to be repeated. It will never be repeated. You should never have a theology that says Christ is always sacrificing himself. No, he died once and for all. That death on the cross at that moment in time and history atoned for all sin, past, present, and future. Christians know that, so we can go straight there. Whereas the people in the Old Testament had to go there indirectly because they didn't have that knowledge. They didn't have that knowledge yet, right? So, and it may, maybe I just leave it there. The sin that plagued Israel plagues the church also. I don't think that there's much of a difference. Then and now we have to confess and repent and turn back to God and ask to be forgiven. And we should really be careful to do that, or the same things that happened to Israel will happen to us. And the Apostle Paul teaches that all of the things that happened in the past happened as an example for us, as a lesson for us. The Jews had what we have in a preliminary form, right? And but we saw what they did with it. Many turned away. Many lost their relationship with God. And so we have to be careful that, you know, that we don't do that. Fortunately, we have a much better sacrifice and also a much better priest and so on. So if anything, studying Leviticus should help us appreciate Jesus more. Steve? Did you want to say something? One way for me to answer would be to say nobody knows. Another way to answer, and this is not exactly a joke, is it had to be somewhere. And this is something that really happened, and so that it's a detail like that tells me that it's not purely symbolic. I mean, this is this is a worship service. It had a certain agenda and order of worship and way things happen in an orderly fashion. And you know, they had to approach from one side. They had to clear the ashes from another side. They had to sacrifice the animal on another side. The several things that were going on had to be separated in some practical way. And there are more spiritual explanations people would give. I mean, it's several places it talks about sacrificing the animal before the Lord. The Lord's presence dwells inside the tent in the middle. And so I read some more detailed things that said the animal, as you were, you know, sacrificing it there, would then be handed to the priest who would turn the face of the cow towards, you know, the tent of meeting and stuff. There's a huge amount of writing outside of the Bible by the rabbis about these things, a sort of extra-biblical Jewish tradition which we could study. And I'm sure they could probably give you 27, you know, different answers, but to me, I'd rather say it was a real activity that had practical considerations, and it just, that's where they did it. I mean, it could even be as simple as Moses wanted to avoid, you know, a bad workflow, you know, inside the tabernacle. So it might be quite busy in there sometimes with different people trying to sacrifice, you know, all the time. That bronze altar is actually huge. And so someplace in the Bible it says, if you have too many sacrifices, you can build additional fires on the altar. So they might have had several different fires burning on that bronze altar. Toka. So I don't know, but. Everyone told me I have to leave on time tonight. I just remember I'm already late. Can we? Okay. Let me pray that you get home safely in the rain. Dear God, I'm so sorry I went over time. Please help everybody to get home safely, even though it's rainy, stormy night. I hope everyone gets home on time and safely and without getting in too much sweat. Thank you, Lord, that you allowed everyone to come here tonight. Thank you for your word. Thank you for Christ, who is the perfect sacrifice, through whom we can atone for our sins and repair our relationship with you and have hope of a blessed eternal life. Please, Lord, continue to bless our study of this very difficult book. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.